These horror movies were banned for being too disturbing, so I'm gonna tell you what they're about. First up, we have a movie that's very controversial, because there were no special effects or prosthetics used. Everything you see in this movie allegedly actually happened. The Bunny Game. This was number 37 in Complex Magazine's 50 most disturbing films of all time, and it was also banned in the UK. So what is this movie actually about? The Bunny Game follows a worker who gets kidnapped by a truck driver, and this truck driver makes her wear a bunny mask as he does unthinkable things to her, which the actress Rodleen Jetsick actually went through when filming. And the director of the movie claims this is because she wanted to use the production as a cathartic process to really purge some of the traumas that she's had. Rodleen even says she considers her acting in this movie more art than film, and that she had to go into a meditative state when filming some of the scenes. But next on the list, we have a movie that's not only banned in the UK, but allegedly 46 countries. A movie from 1978 called The Faces of Death. This movie is about a man named Dr. Francis Gross as he studies the concept of death, telling the viewer he's become interested in the transition between life and death from a recurring dream he's had. So in a documentary-style movie, he's now filming himself in different parts of the world trying to understand what death is. Be prepared, though, that the scenes involving animals are extremely hard to sit through. Even though this movie got mainly negative reviews, it was actually a huge box office success, making $35 million worldwide with a budget of just over $400K. Follow for more disturbing movies.
Alafia! My name is Ocean Amare. On this channel, we uncover the creepiest, most unusual haunted TikToks the internet has to offer. Do me a favor. Please like, comment, and subscribe to the Soul Tribe for your weekly dose of supernatural coming to you every Sunday, Tuesday, and Thursdays, and some bonus days. Y'all, my Soul Tribe. Tribe is with a Y. And the why is for you, because I love you. Thank you for being here with me. Now, let's get into this video.
This is why you should always listen when your parents tell you to stay out of a certain room. Story time. This story was submitted by Maria. I went ahead and tagged her down below. This story took place in Jordan when Maria was a child. Her mom, her brothers, and relatives were visiting her grandparents' house. Quick little side note, Maria's grandparents' house was built over a cemetery back in the 1800s. At about 8 p.m., the adults decided to leave the house and go visit a family friend while the kids stayed behind. At first, everything was perfectly fine. The kids were playing board games, doing anything to stay occupied since the internet was down. That was until one of the older cousins had the bright idea of putting a cell phone into the second living room. This home had two separate living rooms. Now, this second living room was known for having a lot of paranormal activity, so it was forbidden for the children to enter that room. Their plan was to set the phone in the room, leaving it recording a video to see what they could see. This is when things took a really wrong turn. About 6 minutes after they placed the phone in the room, they started to hear knocking and what sounded like groaning noises. One of the older kids told the younger kids to run into the kitchen to start to pray the Quran. They played the TV on loud and started to repeat verses from the Quran over and over again, when out of nowhere the TV completely shuts off and they hear a loud gasp. At this point, Maria loses it. Mind you, she's 9 years old and she starts to do what she knows best, and that is to cry. Maria then convinces the rest of the kids to go into her grandmother's room and hide in there. So all of the kids agree and they run. They shut the door and they sit in there and pray. About 15 minutes later, they start to hear loud thuds and footsteps coming from the hallway. This went on for what felt like forever. At about 3 a.m., the adults made it home. When they got home, they started to question the kids as to why all of the lights in the house were completely off. And why was the bathroom door wide open? The kids were completely confused because no one had turned off any of the lights and no one had touched the bathroom door. Now that the adults were home, the kids felt brave enough to go into that second living room and grab the phone to see what they recorded. When they decide to watch the video, they speed it up and they can clearly see a man slowly making his way towards the phone, and then a woman coming out of the corner looking completely beaten up, groaning in pain and walking towards the phone as well. They realized that this was the groaning sound that they were hearing, and then the man walking like slowly like that was the thud that they also kept hearing. When they showed the video to the adults, they were completely terrified. It has now been 7 years since this took place, and no one, till this day, will dare speak of that day.
Dark things Disney doesn't want you to know, part 16. So today, let's expose one of Disney's very dark policies. So this policy involves all the character actors at Disney. So if you get severely injured while working there, no matter what, you have to stay in character. So one man, before accepting the job as Water Goofy, was told that in event that he started drowning, lifeguards had to carry him away before they could remove his costume and perform CPR on him. He literally could be dying in the costume and need medical attention right away, but Disney won't allow it. Like I said, all characters need to be carried away before any sort of medical attention can be provided. Okay, I get it. They do this in order to preserve the magic at Disney. But come on, that is severely messed up. In fact, because of this policy, a lot of character actors have been severely injured and have gone on to sue Disney. If you want to see more videos like this, then follow me on YouTube. Link in bio.
Y'all, I just saw a video that just bothered my whole soul. For all the parents out there, please stop trying to be the cool parent all the time. Check and see what your kids are doing on their phone. I just saw a story just now about this 12-year-old girl who had been talking to this grown man. This man ended up unaliving this girl. They met up before. Apparently, he had tried to do something to her, and she basically said, I don't want to meet up with you anymore. So he ended up essaying her. Somehow, he got photos of her. I don't know if he took them or she sent photos to him, but he had photos of her body as a 12-year-old girl. He's 24 years old and has these photos of her. Apparently, he threatened her and was like, if you don't meet up with me again, then I'm going to expose these photos. All your friends are going to see how you look. And apparently, she had some like body issues that she wasn't comfortable with. So she meets up with this man again. He literally takes her, unalives her, and burns her and burns the phone like completely. So I just feel like my heart just hurts because I feel like stories like that I hear all the time. My mom, when she used to be like, I ain't one of your little friends, like, I'm truly grateful that she was like that as a parent when I was younger. Yes, was she strict? Yes, was I like, my mom won't let me do nothing? But at the end of the day, I feel like she really prevented things like that. Like, I had legit fear of my mom when I was younger. Like, I'm not about to go meet up with people. I'm not about to go do that. She wouldn't let me go to sleepovers at nobody's house. Nothing like that. So I feel like parents, please go through your kids' phones and give them the attention and energy that they need. Because I promise you, there are predators out here. And they're hiding in plain sight. They're on these social media apps. I had a girl come into my TikTok live that was 10 years old, asking to be my friend. I'm like, girl, you are 10. You can't be my friend. Respectfully, like, thank you for being here. Thank you for supporting me. But I'm a grown woman. I'm not going to have a friend that is 10 years old. I don't even know, like, if her mom knew that she was on this app. I don't know if she's on any other apps, but people, especially kids, they are looking for some type of community. If they don't have, like, a lot of friends in school, if they don't have a lot of people that they speak to, people are predators, and they will really prey on your kids not knowing. People are literally like trying to meet up with children as grown adults. So please, parents, I don't care if it makes you look crazy, please step in and check your kids' phone, see who they're talking to, and allow your kids to have a safe space to speak. That's one thing that my mom instilled so much fear in me that I also felt like when I was growing up, I couldn't really talk to her about certain things. And I feel like it's balance, like creating a strict environment, but also creating a space to where you are allowing your kid to speak freely to you, because I'm sure her parents didn't know what was going on until after she was unalive and they went through her phone. So please, parents, I don't know who that was for. Like, my heart hurts so bad for this girl. If I can find the original story, I'm going to post it. I just literally saw it pop up on my TikTok and it just triggered me and bothered me so badly, because I know that there's so many parents that just give their kids their phone and they just let them go about their day. They don't know who their friends are. They don't know who they're talking to. They don't know what apps they're on. None of that. So parents, please, 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 please check in on your kids and see who they're talking to and what they're doing, because it could really end in something horrible if you don't.
Hey, y'all. I'm the Money Professor. The government hates to tell us how to create generational wealth, how to grow our money tax-free, and how to get out of debt. But what if I told you life insurance was the answer? Would you believe me? That's why so many of my people stay in poverty and end up working until they die. We run away from the thought of life insurance because we were programmed to think only about death insurance. in reality, life insurance is the only vehicle where you can create generational wealth, grow your money tax-free, and have a retirement plan all in one, as well as life insurance. Don't let the government fool you. Life insurance is for the living. That's why it's called life insurance and not death insurance. Comment interested down below and we can schedule a 30-minute consultation to see what best suits you and your needs for your future and your legacy. Talk to you soon.
Y'all already know how I feel about PFALs, honey. They all need their junk chewed off by wild dogs and then need to drink acid so it burns from the inside out. Yes. But that's crazy. And it's really sad that she was essayed, molested, taken advantage of, and then murdered because of somebody else's sick ass disgusting actions on this child. Prayers to her family. May she rest in peace. That's so sad. They need to even just, you know, get intensely electrocuted some way, somehow, even if they have a sick, inappropriate thought. But your home being built over a cemetery in the 1800s, that is crazy. Of course, there's like without a doubt that would be haunted. Like, why wouldn't it be? So I'm not surprised of all the crazy stuff that was going on. But that story was scary. And then the Disney rule, that's crazy. Like, so what if you're about to die? You better not take off that costume. Like, they care more about the characters than the employees and the actual people that are playing these characters. Like, this Disney. Oh goodness. But that's craziness. But yeah. Next video.
So this happened when I was 20 years old. I'm 22 now, so it's not that long ago. While in college, I was a babysitter during the week for a family, and sometimes I would nanny for this other, wealthier family on the weekends. They would go away often on the weekends and leave their two kids, so I would stay at the house for the weekend with the kids. They had a whole dedicated guest bedroom just for me, and the family was super nice, so it was honestly great while it lasted. It happened in the fall. The leaves were all falling and it was chilly outside. I had gotten to the house Friday, and Friday night went completely fine. I just played with the two kids, who I'll nickname James and Jessica. James was 7, Jessica was 5. They were both cute and well-behaved. Their bedtimes were 7:30 for Jessica and 8:30 for James. During the day, I'd play with each of them with their toys. The family had two dedicated rooms for their toys, one for Jess, one for James. Jessica loved her dolls and dollhouses. I spent a lot of time playing with her. James loved playing his video games, so I'd watch him play. These kids really had everything, and the house was gorgeous. It was a giant property with a big pond in the middle. It had a separate 3-car garage, and then a pool with a pool house across the pond, which was also a bar and rec room, with a pool table and darts, arcade games, and a giant TV and multiple sofas. This family was so well off and over the top that they even had an intercom that connected from the pool house to the actual house so that if you press a button on the wall in either place, it would ring and then you could talk through it. The pool house also had a giant window that overlooked the pond and had a view of the house. So after the kids went to bed, I was free to do as I pleased for the night. It was great. I wasn't supposed to have friends over though. That was a rule I respected. I would just FaceTime my friends and watch movies in the pool house to pass the time. It was not a bad place to have free time in, I'll tell you that. I started getting hungry, so I walked back across the property to the house, entered the code to let myself in, and went to the kitchen. They had so many snacks and food that I was allowed to help myself to. I grabbed a frozen snack from the freezer and threw it in the microwave. and when I was done, I went back across the property to the pool house. I liked hanging out in there more because I could be louder on the phone and have the TV as loud as I want without waking the kids. I was on the couch eating, watching the movie White Chicks, while texting a bunch of my friends. I was just in the middle of telling my friends how great of a gig this was, when the intercom beeper gave me a heart attack. I went to go press the answer button, and I heard Jessica's voice on the other end, saying she's scared because she keeps hearing noises. Usually she'd sleep through the night, so I'd have to go tuck her back in. I set my food down and ran back across the yard to the house. I entered through the door with the code lock again and went to Jess's room. She must have ran straight back to her bed after we got off the intercom, because she was already back in her bed all scared. I went to tickle her and tuck her in just so she wouldn't be scared anymore. When she felt better, I left her room, shut the door, and walked down the hall back to the kitchen to grab some wine. As I was looking for a wine opener, I heard the ever so lightest crack in the wood floor from another room. I froze and looked in that direction, instinctively waiting for a second sound. I didn't want to start freaking myself out now. I didn't want Jessica saying she's hearing noises to get in my head. I was thinking it was a regular house settling noise. I admit, I was a little creeped out now, but I left the lights and TV on in the pool house, so I had to go back. I went outside, locked the door with the code, and ran across to the pool house. I sat back down on the couch and resumed eating the rest of my food. I didn't end up bringing the wine. I still had White Chicks on, though I was mostly just getting distracted on my phone. Then that damn intercom went off again, making me jump in my seat. I hurried to answer it, and when I did, there was silence on the other end. "Jessica," I said into the mic. I thought for sure I heard someone breathing, but that's all I could hear. I said both Jessica and James' names at least 3 times each. Now I was actually starting to become terrified. I called my friend Kelsey and told her I want her to come here because I'm actually getting really scared. I told her that the little girl I'm watching said that she was hearing noises, and then I heard a noise, and now someone pressed the intercom button but didn't say anything. I felt like it was not something one of the kids would do. I was still on the phone with Kelsey, who was telling me to stop being paranoid, but she also sounded drunk. I was looking out the window to the house the whole time I was on the phone with her. The hallway lights turned on. I told Kelsey this, and any ounce of possibility that it was one of the kids disappeared when a large figure stepped into...
Oh my gosh, okay, the creepiest thing just happened to me, and I am still shaking, my heart is racing, but I just want to tell you guys about it. Okay, so I get a call on my business line. I'm a realtor, and guy says, "Hey, my name is so-and-so, and I have cash. I'm looking to purchase a home 1 to 3 acres outside of city limits." And I said, "Okay, what is your budget?" And he said, "Doesn't matter." And I thought, okay, that's strange, because even if your budget is $1 million, $5 million, typically people say, I've had buyers say, "My budget is $2 million and, you know, I have cash," and he says, "Doesn't matter." And so I'm thinking, okay, I said, "Well, I'm driving. Send me your first name, last name, and email address, and I will search out some properties. I'll give you a call back and we can talk about numbers then." And he says, "Okay." Then he asks me if I have caller ID, which I thought was really strange. And he starts to make small talk with me about phones. And he says, "My smartphones, I break them all. So I'm talking to you on a flip phone. So I'll probably be like primarily emailing you." And I've just kind of got red flags going. And he says, "I'm from Detroit. I want to be in the country, kind of more isolated in the middle of nowhere." And he said, "I have another question. Do you have high-speed internet outside of city limits? Because I stock trade and I need high-speed internet." And I said, "I don't know. I'll find out for you." And he says, "Okay." And then he asks me who he's speaking with. I tell him my name, that I own the company. And then he cuts out, but he starts to kind of laugh a little bit, and he says the word Detroit. That's the only word I was able to make out. And I said, "I'm sorry, you broke out. What did you say?" And he said, "Never mind. It was a bad joke." And I thought, okay, that's also strange. And I said, "Okay, well, send me first name, last name, email address, and I will get back to you." Get off the phone with him. I have a weird feeling. So I call my husband. I tell him what happened. I said, "This is weird, right?" And he says, "Yes, this is weird. Call the police." And oh, my husband has a system that you can put in the number and it'll tell you who owns the phone number. He owns a business too, and he needs that for his business. So he puts in the number, and he's like, in the 5 years that I've had this and uses, I've never seen it say like nobody found. So I'm freaking out, and I'm like, okay, I'm gonna call the police. I call the police, like, for part two.
Are you serious? First of all, I just want to apologize deeply for you wasting 8 minutes of your life on that bullshit, because they both cut off. Like, I'm so mad that hers cut off, and then the one before that cut off too. And I love me some true scary stories. I sure do, honey. And I'm so mad it cut off. Like, what the heck? Look, my baby, she going crazy. Look at her. She's so cute. He's so cute. All right. Next video.
My neighbor has been mowing his lawn for 12 hours straight. I just figured out the horrifying reason why. It started at 4:43 a.m. The noise jolted me awake. It sounded like there was a giant truck revving its engine right there in our bedroom. Exhaust fumes wafted in through the open window. It was a bad way to start the day. It was even worse than when I saw the neighbor getting it down with his own sibling. Anyways, that's a story for another day.
What is that?
Moaned my wife. We both slept poorly, because our daughter had crawled into our bed at 1 a.m. and kept kicking us in the face until we were both half hanging off the bed while she snored away. Start of the apocalypse, I groaned. Go back to sleep. No way can I sleep through that racket, said Vanessa. She rolled out of bed and shut the window. That helped a little, but it still sounded like war out there. She pulled the curtains back and looked through the window. It's the fucking neighbor. Mowing his lawn. Before the sun is up. We need to have a heart-to-heart with him. Let him know that's not okay. Keegan, our daughter, woke up crying. Guess that's that, I muttered, getting out of bed myself. I'll go talk to him after some coffee. Bring me some too, said Vanessa. Papa, bring me some Smarties, said Keegan. No, no Smarties for breakfast. Banana or toast, but not Smarties. Fine, huffed Keegan. Toast, cut into shapes. I sighed. This was really the last thing I wanted to be doing at 4:45 on a Saturday morning. Making coffee and cutting toast into animal shapes instead of drooling in my sleep and dreaming of a gentler world. I went into the kitchen and started the coffee and toast, and then looked out the living room window. Sure enough, there was Mr. Limsky mowing his damn lawn in his damn bathrobe, no less. That was another thing that I had no desire to do. Get into it with him about this, or really talk to him about anything ever beyond a friendly wave and a howdy neighbor. By the time I was awake enough to form a coherent thought, it was almost 6 o'clock and I had consumed 4 cups of coffee. Mr. Limsky was still at it, which was strange because his yard isn't very big at all. It shouldn't take more than a 40-minute mow job, but here it was, an hour and 15 minutes later, and he was still at it. I got semi-dressed and stumbled outside. I walked across my own yard, which I noted needed mowing itself. Maybe I'll tell him that if he mows my lawn and promises to never start so early again, I'll let it go. But I knew that I wouldn't do that. I was a coward. As I got closer, I observed with some confusion that his lawn was already mowed. He was going over it a second time now. I walked up to our property line, denoted by the contrast between mowed and unmowed grass, and started waving my hands in the air, waiting for Mr. Limsky to notice me. He never did. He just stared straight ahead and kept pushing the mower. Hey! I shouted, but it was no good. I could barely hear myself, and so I knew that he wouldn't be able to hear me from across the lawn, right behind the lawnmower. God damn it. I walked across his yard until I was right behind him. Hey! Nothing. I tapped on his shoulder. Nothing. He just kept pushing the lawnmower onward over the already mowed lawn. I didn't know what to do. I'll catch him after he finishes, I guess. He's in the zone. I shrugged and was getting ready to turn back to my house when I saw a trickle of what was presumably urine run down his bare leg. Jesus. I went back to my house and opened the door. Vanessa was reading a book to Keegan. She stopped when I came in and looked up. Well, he couldn't hear me. I'll go over there once he stops. He's got to stop sometime, right? And, well, I'm a little worried about him, honestly. I saw him, you know, wet himself. Mr. Limsky peed his pants? Asked Keegan. She started laughing. Well, that sometimes happens, kiddo, I said. You used to do that. We do that a lot when we're kids, and then we don't do it for a while, and then when we get older, we sometimes do it again. That gave her something to think about anyway. Huh, said Vanessa. There's more, I said. He's already done with the lawn. He's just going over it a second time. Maybe he missed a few spots? Nope, it's perfect. Not a blade of grass higher than any other blade of grass? Hmm, said Vanessa. That is strange. Do you think he's okay? Should we call somebody? I shrugged. Who are we going to call? The police? Tell them that our retired neighbor is mowing his lawn twice while peeing himself. What will they say to that? Asterisk. By 8 o'clock, I was done cooking the bacon, and Mr. Limsky was still at it, mowing his lawn for what must have been the fifth time. I tried not to think about it, but it was hard. After breakfast, we should go somewhere, I said. It's a beautiful day. No sense staying cooped up all day.
This disturbing video of a dolphin man was responsible for over 800 faintings in 2004 and has just resurfaced after being removed and banned from the internet. I'll tell you his story, but save the video for later if you're a scaredy cat. There's a second, supposedly cursed version of this video that I'll show you in a few seconds, complete with an indefinable scream and strange scrolling text. Some strange people found the videos on the darknet and reposted them a few days ago, perhaps because of the hidden message, which concerns us. Nothing's going right on the internet and TikTok these days. Who is he really? Why is he screaming? And what does the strange scrolling message mean? Some say it sounds like Tarzan in a 1930s film, and that the language used in the text that appears in the video is ancient Armenian. The message left by this dolphin man is chilling and doesn't inspire confidence in the future of mankind. Is it just a theory, or is it reality?
Hello. This is a warning. Please go check outside your home. Please go check outside your home. Please go check outside your home.
Scariest moments caught on camera PT.11.
Be sure to comment, tell me more below if you're open to talk about business. Yeah, Shorty was either high off of some type of drug like Flocka or like K2 or something crazy, or she was possessed because I don't know what the hell was going on with her. And I was going to say she could have been acting, but I doubt that. Her friends were terrified. They were too scared. They even stopped getting close to her. So they locked her ass outside, basically on the porch. But what game was he playing in the first video? It looked real interesting. I have like ADD, so that was like, it was a lot. It was like kind of dreamy, like something that you would see in your dream. Not like that. I don't know. But the story I don't know. What do you think happened to Mr. Lumpskin, whatever the name was, the old guy that was just standing there, just kept mowing the lawn over and over and then end up urinating on himself? I don't know. They should have maybe probably, if that was a true story, I would have like had to call family member, or even maybe 911, because he's in some type of a trance and what's wrong, buddy, wake up. But yeah, next video.
Things that bother you, they never bother me. I'm
happy and fine.
I hope your seatbelt is fastened because this is a gross case. Hi, my name is Ethan and here's everything you need to know in under 1 minute. Fenmen Yi was a 23-year-old girl who was a hostess at a nightclub and she had been struggling with addiction. In early 1997, Fenmen Yi met Chenmen Lok at the nightclub where she worked. It was later determined that Chenmen Lok had money to help Fenmen Yi's addiction problems. One night, she took his wallet and stole $4,000 cash. As soon as he noticed his cash was gone, he enlisted two of his henchmen to take Fenmen Yi. They successfully kidnapped chapter in Frey Month, they beat her, set her on fire, and forced her to eat her own feces. Unfortunately, she eventually succumbed to her wounds, and the three men were arrested and sentenced to life in prison. One crazy fact about this case is they even had a 14-year-old girl help participate in beating Fenmini up.
The man in this photo is one of the worst sexual offenders in the history of Ohio. This man's name was Brian Peppers. For years, this photograph circulated on the internet attached to his story of sexual abuse, and nobody believed that it was real. But some fact-checking was eventually done, and yes, Brian Peppers was a real man with a real peppered past. So, Brian was born with something called Cruzon syndrome. And when Brian was younger, he was bullied incessantly by people in his school. So, as Brian grew older over the years, his body quickly began to grow weaker, and eventually his mental health deteriorated to such a point that he had to be checked into a nursing home. But it was in the year 1998 when Brian was arrested and convicted of molesting somebody. According to the report, he actually sexually abused the nurse that was taking care of him in the nursing home. Brian was then removed from the nursing home. He spent 30 days in jail, and he was on probation for 5 years. After this incident, Brian was on the sex offenders registry in Ohio up until his death. When he died, Brian Peppers was only 4'1" tall, and he passed away on February 7th, 2012, which, eerily enough, is the day that I'm posting this TikTok, and I didn't even realize it until I read that just now. According to a recent lawsuit that was filed, P. Diddy might be a pedophile. This new lawsuit alleges that P. Diddy constantly held parties at his house that involved minors, adults who were assaulting these minors, male and female sex workers that were servicing everybody, and this lawsuit even alleges that P. Diddy himself spiked people's drinks at the party to get them looser and convince them to do whatever he wanted them to do. This lawsuit came from one of P. Diddy's former employees, a man nicknamed Little Rod. And this lawsuit is incredibly disturbing and paints a picture of Epstein-level allegations. Allegations that P. Diddy may have been involved in a trafficking ring of sorts. Allegations that P. Diddy forced his employees to go out and procure sex workers for him and his parties. Allegations that P. Diddy violently forced people to do things for him. Allegations that P. Diddy may have murdered people and admitted to it. Amongst many, many other allegations of assault, groping, and yeah, just so many different things. These are some really disturbing allegations, and while they haven't obviously been proven to be true in court yet, the team that actually put these allegations forward claims that they have hundreds of hours of video and audio evidence incriminating P. Diddy and his entire team in this string of illegal acts. I'm sure that this is going to be some really disturbing stuff. I'm going to be sure to cover this story as it unfolds more. And yeah, if this is all true, this is extremely dark and disturbing stuff. And I think that this web is going to spread very far across the music industry. The girl in that video, 21-year-old Erica Lawson, allegedly sold her own daughter to 6 pedophiles so that they could abuse her. And after this assault was finished, the 17-month-old baby Elena died. Now, this case is absolutely horrific, and it tells the story of someone whose image on social media is completely opposite who they are in real life. So, on Erica Lawson's TikTok page, which is still up, she's posted a ton of videos featuring her and her daughter dancing around, seemingly enjoying life. But behind closed doors, Erica was a closeted drug addict. And since details are pretty sparse in this case, and a lot of this is still alleged, this is what we know. At one point in 2023, Erica allegedly sold her daughter to at least 6 men. And when 17-month-old Elena's dead body was discovered, she had been brutalized, beaten, and some people even say she was beaten with a baseball bat. Now, like I said, details in this case are pretty sparse, but from what I could find on news sources, there were 6 DNA samples that were sent off for further analysis. 6 more people, I'm assuming men, that will be charged with this crime. And it's been recently announced that prosecutors are going to be seeking the death penalty against Erica, meaning that if convicted, she could be put to death for this horrific crime. It's absolutely mind-blowing and just disgusting and disturbing that a woman could ever even think about doing this. I mean, allegedly selling your own child to pedophiles to abuse, and then the child dies after this abuse. This is truly one of the most horrific, most disgusting, most disturbing stories I've ever covered. If you guys want to help, head to change.org and help sign this petition, Elena's Law, created by Haley and Haven Lawless. The petition has over 6,000 signatures, and the people who created it are basically asking the legislature in Kentucky to provide harsher sentences for child predators. Something that I 100% agree with, and yeah, I signed the petition, you definitely should too. And I really hope that this despicable woman is punished to the fullest extent of the law.
This photo is of the Cincinnati crawler. It was taken by a family who caught him in their home in 1974, but he escaped shortly afterwards. So in 1974, the Johnson family in Cincinnati noticed a couple weird things happening in their home. The 14-year-old daughter, Claire, would complain about seeing glowing eyes outside of her window at night. And then one night, the youngest son, Timmy, was laying in bed in the dark when he felt the family dog jump up onto his bed. But when he went to go pet it, it was not the dog. It was the crawler, who police still believe was responsible for the disappearance of four other boys in the area. Some believe that he was an escaped convict, while others actually believe that he was the victim of human experiments happening in the area that may have been conducted by the family's dad. Claire snapped this photo of him before he escaped, but he was never found since.
I saw the Hat Man with my own two eyes. Before I begin, make sure to follow my other socials here and subscribe to my YouTube channel because I'm going to be posting story times there. So if you're unfamiliar with the Hat Man and his lore, he's basically a tall, skinny figure that's been around since, honestly, forever. So he looks something like this, and he has very little to no features. Since he's mainly seen in the dark, he's almost like a shadow. He also appears if you have sleep paralysis or if you took like a large dose of Benadryl. Now, some have claimed that the Hat Man will appear and then disappear throughout the night, and apparently sometimes he will attack if you've seen him a total of 3 times. It's crazy though, because my encounter with the Hat Man happened a few years ago when I got the stomach bug. So I became really sick, I was bedridden, like I literally could not move because of the pain that was happening down here. Now, disclaimer, if you warm up your food and parts of it is still cold, do not eat it because you will get sick just like me. Anyways, on the first night of me having the stomach bug, I was quite literally dead. Like, my mom had to stay home from work to take care of me. Throughout the day, I was taking so much medicine, which honestly didn't help at all because I just kept throwing it up. And because I kept throwing up and throwing up and throwing up, everything that I consumed, I just became so weak. To the point where it was hard to walk, even just like a few steps. Fast forward, it's night, and I decided to sleep on the couch rather than in my room because it's closer to the bathroom. So you know I wouldn't have to walk so far, and if I needed to throw up, I could just go right there. So keep this in mind, before everyone went to sleep, my mom gave me my last dosage of medicine, which happened to be Benadryl. And since my mom was giving it to me, you know, I literally just opened up my mouth and she would spoon it down my throat. But honestly, I think she ended up giving me a large dosage on accident. Fast forward again, it's around 1 a.m. in the morning and I'm awoken to my stomach killing me. I just remember having to get up from the couch and just sitting there for a bit because of how much pain I was in. So keep in mind at this point, all the lights are off. The only light that I can see right now is the digital clock that's on the bottom of my TV. So I can see just like a little bit of what's in front of me. I kid y'all not, I rubbed my eyes for 1 second. Just like this, I open them back up, I see a tall figure standing there at the hallway. So I couldn't figure out if it was looking at me or if it had its back turned, but all I remember is that I got instant chills, like just chills running down my body. I also remember that it started to slowly walk into the kitchen. So at this point, I'm confused, but I'm not really afraid because I knew that as nighttime comes, sometimes my family members, they get up and they go to the kitchen, you know, to get like a late night snack. Or, you know, they come downstairs to use the bathroom. So honestly, I just assumed that it was my brother. So right after I watched this figure, you know, walk into the bathroom, I instantly get this feeling that I need to throw up. So I get up and I hurry to the bathroom. So while I was in the bathroom doing whatever, I remember I kept hearing things happening outside of the door. Like, there was just so much unusual movement coming from outside of the bathroom. After I was done, not gonna lie, I opened the door and I got jump scared by my dad. He was standing there, he was asking me if I was okay, yada yada yada. So I ended up telling him that I was fine, and I did ask him if he was standing in the hallway like a while ago. So he ended up telling me that it wasn't him. Like, he was not downstairs, and I was just like, oh, okay, then who was there just a while ago. So after, I watched my dad go upstairs and I turn off the bathroom light, and once again, it's pitch black. So here's where it just got really weird. So after I turned off the light and it's pitch black, I walked back to the couch and I got this like sudden urge to look up my staircase where my dad was just at, where he just like walked up. And guys, keep in mind, I know my parents' footsteps. Like I literally heard my dad upstairs walking to his bedroom. Tell me why I'm looking up my staircase and I see a tall figure just standing there at the top. Mind you, I literally just heard my dad walk to his bedroom. So how could he walk to his bedroom, then back to the top of the staircase? That can't happen. So I remember the figure was just standing there. And at this point, I'm laughing to myself because I'm like, okay, is my dad trying to play a prank on me? Because if so, it's just not working. But as I look closer, this figure was skinny and tall. And how my house is set up, where the staircase is at the top, there's a window. And that window, there's a light like facing it kind of, the streetlight. So I can like, when the streetlight is on, you can like see stuff kind of shining through. And I could see that this figure had on a small top hat. I remember in this moment, it felt really hard to breathe. And I got the same chills again. And I wanted to hurry back to the couch. So as I'm laying down on the couch, I'm thinking to myself, I'm like, am I tripping? But at the same time, I'm like, no, I'm not tripping because I literally saw this figure twice. But at this point, I'm thinking to myself, okay, the house is haunted with the ghost. So I remember I took my phone out and I looked up tall, skinny figure with hat. And the first thing that came up was the Hat Man. So as I'm on my phone, I'm doing some more research, and that's when I discovered that people have said that if you see him 3 times, he will attack. Now, mind you guys, I just saw him for the second time. So at this point, I'm filled with fear. I'm petrified because I don't want to get attacked. No. Mm-mm. I remember I immediately shut my phone off and I turned my body to face the couch because maybe if I'm looking at the couch, it will stop my chances from seeing this Hat Man ever again. And I was so wrong because as soon as I turned my body, I felt the same chills again. So at this point, I knew that the Hat Man was standing right there. Honestly, probably hovering above me. As scared and as sick as I was, I remember I went into survival mode. I remember thinking to myself that the only way to get rid of this thing is by waking everyone in the house up. So in this moment, I decided to forcefully push my weak self off the couch in hopes that if I fall, I'll make a thump noise, and if I scream, someone will hear and they'll wake up and everyone will come downstairs. Unfortunately, my screaming didn't even work because it didn't even sound like a scream. It was just me going, Because mind you, I'm sick, and pushing myself off the couch just made my body hurt even more. But luckily, I do remember hearing someone rush downstairs, which happened to be my dad. Long story short, my dad decided to sleep downstairs with the TV on with me, and I never saw the Hat Man again. My plan ended up working in the end, but I personally wonder, what would have happened if I didn't push myself off this couch and make noise? What would have happened if I turned around to see the Hat Man staring at me for the third time? I would have gotten attacked. Because as sick as I was, if he attacked me, I would have been over. It would have been over for me.
Yeah, that bitch is sick. She is sick. Like, she needs gangbanged on a daily, on a nightly, in the worst way possible. Where she's screaming for, begging for them to stop. Because how could you do that to your baby? And then, ooh, child. Go sign that petition. Because, yeah, I too feel that P-Files do not have a harsh enough. They don't, their penalties that they get, and it's not, no, they need life. They need to be charged as if they did a murder when you're doing stuff to innocent children, period. Oh my gosh. But, also RIP to, Femme, the Hello Kitty story is wild. I don't know if you guys ever heard that story. You should look into it. He did her dirty, all about $4,000. Yeah, she shouldn't have stole it, but dang. And then they did it for 30 days. That's crazy. But the clip, he looked terrified, going around and terrorizing and essaying people. I would be terrified too if I was in that, like if that was that, in that, if it was his room at nighttime, honey, yeah, no. I would be terrified too, looking at that. Like, I don't know what the, I forget what disease they said he had, but yeah. Then you're going around, like, how are you trying to molest on somebody that's taking care of you? Like, what? Weirdo? Look like a weirdo too. Like, But Diddy is a straight freak of nature. Like, I really want to know what's going to happen, what's going to be the ending of all of this stuff he has going on right now. I hope he gets punished for what he has done and all the traumas and devastation that he caused to so many people, allegedly, and as well as everybody involved and everybody keeping them secrets. Y'all know who y'all are. So everybody needs a little, get a piece of little, more than a smack on the hand, but you know what I'm saying. Next video.